So it just doesn't seem fair, does it, that guys like us are going to die on the average 7 years younger than women? You'd think, especially natural selection, if it wanted to favor males, could have at least allowed us to live longer, but we don't. So is it just here in this country and in Western society? No, it turns out to be every place. I got data from the World Health Organization that lists mortality rates, what percentage of people die at each age, for 20 different countries at different ages of life. And I wanted to figure out, for every 100 women who die, how many men die at age 20? And my guess was, oh, about 120 men die for every 100 women who die, about a 20% excess. But when I looked at the data, for every 100 London women age 20 who die, 300 men die. The death rate is 3 times higher. I was flabbergasted, even though I was a properly educated doctor. No one had ever mentioned this. And then I looked at 20 other countries. Same pattern in every country. It ranges between about 2.5 and 5 for that peak. Then I looked across the age span. Throughout the entire lifespan, males die more. So how come? Why did natural selection discriminate against men? And of course, once again, we're back to trade-offs. Males that invested more in competition and certain kinds of muscular vigor and all the rest ended up having more offspring than other men. There's variation in the amount of investment in that kind of reproductive competition. For women, competing for mates doesn't influence the amount of babies they have very much. Most women can find a mate, and they don't have to compete in the same way. As a result, natural selection has invested much more of life's energies into mate competition for males and less in females. So for us, we have less investment in repairing our tissues. And as a result, we die.
Those 300 that you mentioned, what are they actually dying of?
We actually looked at that. It turns out that for the 20 leading causes of death, 19 of them are higher for males. And we also looked to see if it was all explained by riding motorcycles without a helmet and drinking too much too fast and unsafe sex. About half of it's accounted for by those behavioral kinds of factors. But cancer, lots of other things as well, pneumonia, they're more frequent and more deadly for males. So our bodies seem to be designed, and it's in other species too, of course. If you look at chimpanzees, you see the same pattern. The males are competing and fighting and dying young on average compared to the females.
So let me see if I got this right. We're all governed by compromises, and there's a compromise between reproduction and long life, and that applies to both sexes.
That's the big compromise.
That's the big compromise. But the compromise comes out at a different place for males than for females, because for females, they can reproduce more if they live a longer time and have a child and then another one and then another one and then another one. But for males, it's not like that? Is that what you're saying?
Well, in a sense, they can live longer, and some people have suggested, in fact, particularly Ruth Mace, who does research right here at University College London, has looked at whether lifespan for females has been increased because women make good grandmothers and therefore help their own genes.
Well, I was going to say, because, I mean, on the face of it, we're contradicted by the menopause, aren't we? Because men can go on reproducing well into old age,
so
whereas
in that,
women can't.
In that same 1957 paper, George Williams suggested a possible explanation for menopause. He said, it may be that after a certain age, the risk of pregnancy in terms of killing a woman and resulting in the death of her existing children back in ancestral times would be so great that it would be better for her to stop reproducing herself and instead take care of her children and her grandchildren. Now, since then, there have been a dozen papers published on this with mathematical models and data, and it's beginning to look like he had the right idea of an answer. It looks like women who do stop reproducing may have a better ability to care for children and grandchildren, and they get in the... It's still a controversial issue, actually.
Were all of us descended from an unbroken line of ancestors, not a single one of whom died young.
Yes.
But they all potentially died old, many of them died old. Would that be one way of summarizing the whole Darwinian medicine?
And those who died at age 20, on the average, had fewer offspring than those who died at age 40 or 60. So indeed, everything is a trade-off, and there's variation, which has resulted in selection for genes that maximize reproduction. Usually they maximize health also, but not always.
So we're really not designed for health, we're designed for reproduction, and if there's any competition between those, reproduction wins.
That's right, absolutely. It's a sad thought, isn't it?
It doesn't mean we all have to rush around reproducing like crazy.
No, it certainly doesn't. In fact, it might make you think that maybe natural selection has played a bit of a trick on us, encouraging us to do things that are good for our genes, but not necessarily good for us.
I think it is important to remember that although natural selection does explain why we're here, it doesn't provide us with a recipe for how we ought to behave
it
necessarily, morally or politically or anything like that.
No. And even, I mean, finding out that on the African savannah there were good reasons for eating a lot of fat and sugar, that's not a good reason for eating a lot of fat and sugar. And what's worse, even knowing that doesn't really change much our ability to resist eating those tasty things.
Why is life so full of suffering?
You know, it's such a profound and awful question, you hardly dare touch it. But thinking about it from an evolutionary point of view, there's a quite specific answer. Most of the kinds of suffering we experience, whether it's pain or even vomiting or fever or anxiety or depression, those are adaptive defenses in their place. The question is, why do they get dysregulated? Why do we have so much of them when we don't really need it? And it's because of how natural selection has shaped the mechanisms that regulate them. It shaped them to go off when they could possibly be useful, because most of them are inexpensive. And as a result, many of us spend our lives feeling like we're missing something, or too anxious or depressed or something, or in pain. And we don't need these feelings in modern life especially, but even in earlier life. But they've been good for our genes, for our ancestors, on the average, so we have them.
It's the smoke detector principle again.
It is the smoke detector principle. It has profound implications for the future and our ability to change human life. You know, right now we're in the midst of a revolution in psychopharmacology where we're beginning to use medications to influence our anxiety and our mood and all of the rest. Usually that's talked about in terms of the brain being broken in some way, and in many people it is. But in many people, they're having more of an emotional negative response than is useful. And blocking that response with medications is just as useful and appropriate as blocking a fever with aspirin. And it's doing very much the same kind of thing. But the key is thinking about what we're doing. And the key to thinking about what we're doing is asking the evolutionary question about why hasn't natural selection made the body better?
Right. Randy, I know that you wrote a book with George Williams. In America, it's called Why We Get Sick. In Britain, it's called Evolution and Healing, and it really should be called The Dawn of Darwinian Medicine.
We tried to call it that. They wouldn't let us.
Yes. Publishers are like that. But nowadays, that book's quite old now, but there's still a lot of good stuff in it. But what about now? Is there anything else you could recommend?
Well, it turns out that there are two other books by Oxford Press, one called Evolutionary Medicine, another called Evolution, Health and Disease. It came out about 6 years ago. Both have new editions coming out early in 2008. So that's happening fast. Also, there's a new organization called Evolution and Medicine. And anyone who's interested can go to evolutionandmedicine.org, all one word. And that's the latest information. You can even get on an email list to find out where the latest meetings are and what's happening in the field.
Okay, I'll go there myself.
Great.